Okay, good evening and welcome to the March 27th meeting of the school committee. I call this meeting to order at 7 o'clock. This meeting is being both audio and videotaped by LCAT. Is anyone doing either of these? Thank you. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag, the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, starting to my left.
Jamie Thomas.
Gregory Thompson.
Deirdre Mayhew.
Rich Fuchero.
Bill Fonseca.
Gordon Smith, Superintendent of Schools.
Elizabeth Marcy Boucher.
Valerie Mayer, Assistant Superintendent for Curriculum and Instruction.
Pamela Blair, Assistant Superintendent for Business.
Okay, moving along to item two, approval of minutes. Item 2.1, approval of the March 13th, 2017 executive session meeting minutes. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion that we accept the March 13th, 2017 executive session meeting minutes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on this? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. 2.2, approval of the March 13th, 2017 regular session meeting minutes. Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve the March 13th, 2017 regular session meeting minutes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on these? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Moving right along to committee and subcommittee communications. Yemi, start us off.
Last week, the 10th graders did the English and Long Comp MCAS, and term three is ending this Friday. So that's something that lots of people are focused on.
Yeah. Okay. Greg?
I have nothing this evening, thank you.
Deirdre?
I don't have anything either, thank you.
And Mr. Thompson, you and I enjoyed Makerspace last week.
Oh, we did, yeah, we all did. We did, you're right. Please, continue.
Go ahead, talk about it.
So, yeah, so finally, Tim Allen nailed down the date.
Yes, he did.
And I enjoyed my time with Bill and Greg. It was really quite, I counted 51 students there. And Dr. Allen said some kids did not show up for whatever reason. But more than that, that was amazing.
It was rescheduled three times, that could be the reason.
And the second thing is, in a collaborative meeting, the teacher recognition, the list is phenomenal. Going from, I think it's 20 years to 40 years for one of our staff members, who's seated right there. Dr. Welch has been with us 40 years.
Wow.
You know, so that's, I think, Thursday, June 8th. Yeah, it's quite a list.
Anything else? Hey, Beth?
We're working on parent negotiations, and that seems to be going well. We've got a couple more meetings, hopefully, and that'll be it. And I just have to give a shout out to Maple Shade and Michael Fredette, because although I didn't go, I did see the video that Mr. Smith had shown us about the Learning Carnival. It was packed. I'm sad I didn't go, because I wasn't even on my radar, but the cafeteria was packed. It was standing room only. It looked like the kids had a really great time, and I'll send some kudos out to him for that. And who did it? John
Wiedersheim.
Yep.
I think the finished product should be up on their website soon, the video.
Yeah,
that was pretty neat.
I'm just going to piggyback to what Rich said. Yeah, the Makerspace was a very well put together event, and the kids were really enthusiastic. I mean, they really gave it their everything to try and get this project to work, and two of the teams actually succeeded. So it's very well, and you know, kudos to Tim finally and his staff for finally pulling it off. So it was a good time. Okay, moving along to item four, opportunities for visitors to address the committee. Seeing none, we will move right into item five, presentations. Superintendent's report, item 5.1.1, the new special education course, personal wellness.
Okay, we have Dr. Welch here, Dr. Flanagan, and Ms. Reed here. They're going to come up, and this is a potentially new course at East Long Meadow High School for next year. And I'm going to walk you through it. It connects with much of the items that we've been talking about as we've been building our budget for next year, when we started to talk about challenges that all our schools are facing around social and emotional challenges our students are facing, which often get in the way of learning.
So good evening. I'm really happy to be here tonight, because I feel that Dr. Flanagan and the high school's initiative is finally a step forward towards what has been one of my goals, which is sort of finishing the array of services that we offer in the district. And the piece that I always felt was lacking was supporting students' social and emotional needs, particularly as those needs impact the students' learning. And so with the resources that we've had available in the past, we certainly did our best to do research and to try to develop some programs that did, in fact, at least address the tip of the iceberg in terms of promoting more social and emotional wellness in our schools. And we've done that in all five schools. I think it's no secret to anyone who works with families in the district and knows that there are challenges that all students face every day. And we are thankfully finally able to start to address that situation here at the high school. In some of our research, Dr. Flanagan and I and the two assistant principals, some of the school counselors, had the opportunity to reach out to some local practitioners in the mental health field. Additionally, many of us, and I know some of you, also attended the presentation by Lynn Lyons, which was really informative and certainly helped to confirm some of what we were already contemplating. So from that, there are two very simple takeaways that are supported by research as well as best practices. And the two recommendations for the course or for any program in our schools would be, one, that it is skills-based, that rather than promoting what one of our long time ago speakers, Maria Trazzi, used to call the well of sorrow, you know, rather than promoting that, that we arm our students with skills and strategies in order to address some of the challenges that do cause angst, if you will, in a young person. And the second caveat, I think, that was really instilled in us when we met with people was the focus should be keeping students in school and, in fact, returning them to class. So rather than, again, creating, I don't want to say that the program is not going to be supportive. It certainly is supportive. But more importantly, I feel very good that the focus of the program is going to be skills and teaching students skills that they can generalize throughout the school day. So Dr. Flanagan was very innovative in terms of developing a course, if you will, that will be part of the repertoire of opportunities that some students have in selecting courses here at the high school. And so I'll turn it over to her now to kind of present what that course will be.
Thank you, Dr. Walsh. And Dr. Walsh is very helpful in terms of kind of helping us outline and put this all together. So I want to give her recognition for that. One of the things I think you've heard from the district collectively is that we're seeing a rise in students with IEP needs in terms of social, emotional, behavior disabilities. And ideally, we'd like to build a really comprehensive program that not just a one single course, but something that is a lot more comprehensive in the services it offers students. And I hope someday that we can work to do that. But in the meantime, I know at the high school, one of the things we're seeing a great deal is the students who come to us and they are either filled with anxiety, they're not able to kind of navigate the regular school day due to a number of different reasons, and we felt it was time for us to take action. And as Dr. Welch mentioned, we've been talking to healthcare providers, we've been kind of consulting with other districts to see what's in place. And this is, I think, a great first step in helping students meet their needs. I think ideally, we eventually want to see a program where not just a single course, but eventually services could be done in school. And one of our goals is, whenever possible, we want to keep our students in East Long Meadow. We want to keep the kids with their peers. So this is the community that they live in. So the more we can do to support them, I think, is best. So just in a nutshell, I'm going to talk a little about the course, and then I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Reed. So the course is essentially called Personal Wellness, and I provided you a list of different units that students might be engaged in. So anything from self-awareness to health and wellness, helping students deal with issues of, you know, personal hygiene and anxiety and the power of positive thinking. Also, some of our students that are would be candidates for this class often struggle with time management, organizational skills. A lot of them struggle with social relationships. So giving them those opportunities to grow in those areas. We also want them to be responsible citizens. So there's a whole unit on how they can extend themselves outside the classroom. Ideally, I'd like to see them learn about voting and, you know, how you can be more active in your community as well. And we also want to provide them daily living skills, such as, you know, how to balance a checkbook. All of these are things that we take for granted that our kids know. And kids who are struggling with emotional disabilities and social disabilities, it's even more of a struggle. So this class is really focused on helping those students just be responsible citizens. The course is designed primarily to hit kids that have on their 504 or their IEP's specific need for this accommodation, and that's kind of where we're starting with at this point. We'd like this course to also satisfy a requirement for either health, PE, or practical arts. As you can see by the units involved, there's a lot of health, there's a lot of PE, and there's a lot of practical arts. The whole business piece is built in there too. So we feel like it gives those students an opportunity to fill that requirement as well. We're hoping for it to be a full year course, 4 credits. Right now we're aiming toward 2 sections of it for next year, so there'll be a 9th and 10th grade version of it, and then there'll be 11th and 12th grade, because the needs of the upperclassmen are very different. They're actually getting ready to go into the college and the career, so their topics might be slightly different. So I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Reed, because I think you're going to hear from Ms. Reed her expertise in this area, which I think is going to make the program run really smoothly and successfully.
Before you do, can I just hop in for one quick minute, which is to say it also fulfills a mandate through special education, which is now called transition planning. There's actually an addendum to all IEP documents for students once they turn 14 that requires school districts to address all students' needs in terms of employment, community living, and specific instruction. And so starting to foster some of those links, I think, is going to be a huge step forward for us as well. I'm sorry, Lynn.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for having me here tonight. So my name is Lynn Reed. I'm one of the special education liaisons here at Eastline Meadow High School. I've been here for 12 years. Prior to that, I was a teacher in Springfield Public Schools for 16 years in the social-emotional program. I'm also a certified school adjustment counselor, which I think is going to be excellent in working with the students for this class, because not only can I address their academic needs, the needs that are addressed and identified in their transition plans and their IEPs, but I can also do that school adjustment counseling. How can I be successful and be in class and be very successful in my classes?
She's actually, Miss Reed, if you know her, she's kind of like the mom of all the kids. They always flock to her. So she was the perfect candidate for something like this. So we're grateful that she's going to take this on. And she has a ton of experience with it, too. We also are playing with the idea of making it a team approach. So in addition to Miss Reed, we were thinking that we'd have our adjustment counselor also be in the classroom. And then at the certain unit where they start talking about life choices, Mr. Macarini, who's our career counselor, he would come in and kind of help the kids navigate, you know, how do you complete a resume? How do you interview for a job? These are all things that these kids traditionally struggle with, and we're trying to provide them a service that we think that they desperately need.
Okay. Questions?
Well, I think you've answered a lot of the questions that I have, which I appreciate. But my thing is, will there be a limit on the class size, or will you allow like the same number of kids you would in a regular?
So right now we're generating the class list by IEP accommodations that specifically say that they need these kind of services, right, and 504s. You know, one of the things that plays a part in it is staffing. So right now we're trying to kind of accommodate the needs for the RFLs that we have, mm-hmm, and the other services we have. But eventually, you know, if it becomes one of those classes that can be adapted to meet, you know, a larger population, we'd be all for it.
So you're kind of starting off slow to see really what the response is going to be.
You know, we offer like personal finance at the high school. We offer courses in isolation, but this course is kind of like a well-rounded, you know, here's how to be successful in life. And remember, it's a class that has to meet a certain level of students who traditionally struggle with these skills. So it definitely fits that special education population very well right
and
now.
And that's something by smaller classroom size.
Correct.
Too, so you can give a little more individualized attention during that time.
I think we already started to identify at least 15 kids, and it's probably, it could grow.
Right.
And that's the other great thing about it is, you know, sometimes like mid-year, we'll get requests for a 504 needs or kids coming in from the,
right.
It'll be a nice class where we can migrate them in, and it'll be an easy transition for them.
And do you have a class in
yes.
a classroom in
yeah,
mind?
That's problematic right okay. now, but we're working on it.
it just goes to show that they're really maxing
right.
out. It's
yeah. We definitely
out
need
a designated
area just for this course, and that's something mm-hmm. we're going to have to work on.
Is it a half year, or are you going to let them come and go? Like, say if you find somebody with needs mid-year, how do you work
yeah, on that's going to be really challenging because we do want it to be a full-year course
right.
because there's so much we want to offer the students, so that's definitely going to be a struggle.
Yeah.
I know one of the things we've talked about is, you know, do you allow kids to come in and out? Like, once they feel that, you know, maybe that their parents, because that happens. Sometimes our parents will pull them out of an RFL, you know,
yeah.
because they don't feel they need the services anymore. So that's definitely going to be challenging, and we're going to have to kind of played out, and we're actually, Miss Reed is going to be working on developing the actual curriculum this summer. We're going to be using some of our building-based funds to help with that piece.
Is it all kids on 504s and IEPs, or just ones that you feel really fit?
I think we're going to have to look at the IEPs to see if they're a candidate, because all social emotional accommodations are different. So there are some students who need like there are kids that could need every single one of these units, and then there are some who just might need, like, you know, minimal services. So I think it's going to be kids within we view as really struggling and comprehensive needs in all these areas.
Who needs specifically designed instruction.
All right.
Correct.
It doesn't mean if, like, the state's not saying if you're on an IEP, you have to.
Oh, no.
No, no, no,
no,
no.
They won't.
Yeah. The IEPs often state things like help with executive functioning skills, organizational skills. You know, so, you know, teaching students how to utilize a calendar or their iPhone or any way they can utilize any tools to help them be more successful in reminding themselves of certain events or time frames. So all of those executive functioning skills that we sometimes take for granted, some of our kids really struggle with that. So there'll be units just to kind of accommodate those needs.
And teaching things like mindfulness and stress reduction and, you know, just ways to kind of frame a situation so that you can return to class. And generalize what you've learned in the classroom, you know, throughout the school day in your own school with your own peers and your own teachers in your own community.
And just as a general statement, this is probably just another one of those avenues that's coming to light mm-hmm. with the social emotional mm-hmm. urgency that all of a sudden has come upon us in the last year.
Yeah, we see a lot of kids who during the day might need a timeout for whatever reason.
Right.
They get
right.
so stressed out and they don't know how to deal with the situation that happened with their peers or something happened at home. Hopefully this class will give them a foundation of, you know, how do you navigate those situations? So, as she said, keep them in class
right.
and be able to power through some of those mm-hmm. challenges that they face.
I think the list, you know, the proposed units are things that all students
should
yes.
right.
have. The
yeah.
truth.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
We offer these in isolation. So like in health class, you'll see a lot of this, like personal hygiene.
Yeah.
Right.
But
yeah, right.
but these kids, it's like we're really honing in on making it really hyper-focused because a lot of them need that specific structure. So I think it's a little bit different, but I think it's definitely something we need. I feel very strongly.
Absolutely.
I like that you're making it in lieu of the regular health class, too, because
yes.
there's so many things that they have to take.
Exactly.
They want to take, and it won't hold them back.
I've been holding them back. I have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Oh,
I have
do?
A problem with fulfilling health practical after PD. I do. I think
yeah.
PE is much different than this. I think practical arts is much different than this. I do have a problem with.
But what with health, though? Is the health part
I have a problem. Though, I have a problem satisfying any of those graduation requirements.
I will tell you, though, Mr. Ficero, that some of the candidates that would be in this class have not been successful in PE because they're stressed out about being around their peers. And so I can think of one student right now who was unsuccessful in passing PE for 2 years because he just couldn't deal with the stress of competition or, you know, just the whole the emotional piece that's tied to this class. So being very thoughtful, and that's good feedback, as we develop the class, you know, how can we provide the instruction in those areas? And I know exactly what you mean, but making sure that we're working really hard to meet those curriculum pieces that they might miss. And just remember, too, this would only satisfy one. So it might, I would believe that the student could probably determine which graduation requirement. So like, for example, they might use this in lieu of health, but they still have to take PE. So it wouldn't be that it takes the place of health all at the same time. Does that make sense?
Some students, it gives them the opportunity to really work on focused goal setting so that, that might be something then that if it is an area that, I'll use physical education as an example, that perhaps creates some anxiety. You know, our goal is obviously not to wipe the requirement away, but in fact to give the students the skills and the strategies that are necessary to address that very important requirement.
I guess procedurally, first, as you can tell, all five of us are very excited about the course. So this is just, to make a blanket statement, I don't think I could agree with it. I mean, I could understand if when you decide to choose these kids, that it's written in the IEP that this course is in lieu of blank. Mm-hmm. But a blanket statement that this one course can be used in either of these three areas, I'm uncomfortable.
What if we did?
Because you change the graduation requirements, yeah. That's a different motion than the course.
When and who decides?
Right.
Yeah.
What if we put into place, similar to what we do with foreign language with special education students, a waiver of some sort?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. If it's done on an individual basis,
yes, I agree.
You're sitting with Dr. Flanagan.
Yep, I agree.
Me,
right.
And the PE, the student that's having trouble in PE, it's written to the IEP in lieu of. Not a blanket statement.
Correct. I agree.
That's all I'm saying. Yes. Procedural.
I would just want to emphasize that this is something that is going to align very closely with the IEP and transition planning process.
So, I mean, do we even need that last sentence in there? The course description. Do you need that last sentence there?
I'm sorry.
The last sentence, this course meets the graduation requirements for health care. Do we really need that last sentence?
Or can you have that sentence the team will determine.
The team, yes.
There you go.
Would you actually specifically write it in the IEP that this class will be taken and will meet that requirement?
Yes.
So that's really when it would be discussed.
Yeah.
And then just one other question kind of to that point. There's two sections of 9, 10, 11, and 12. Would students typically be in all 4 years necessarily, or would they do a 9-10?
I could think of some students who could benefit from 4 years, but I also can think of students that, 1 year, maybe in 11th, 12th grade year might be sufficient. Mm-hmm. It's not something I see somebody, unless it's like somebody who's really, really struggling cognitively and emotionally, that would be in this for the 4 years. I think that would be the exception, but not the rule.
And then so then the off years, they would have the opportunity to take the PE and the health.
Yeah. Ideally, if we had a comprehensive program, we would have support staff, embedded in the school day so that students could receive services while they're here. So it wouldn't really necessarily always need a course like this. It would just be kind of like a stepping stone to that. But
right. Because I see this as possibly, as you said, Dr. Flanagan, not necessarily 4 years.
Right.
But somebody that needs the organizational skills as they grow older. It may not be 9 and 10. It could be, as you said, 11 and 12, where they just need that extra piece.
Yeah.
So I don't view this as a four-year, unnecessarily as a four-year course, a four-year requirement.
Right.
Well, the goal of all special education is independence and generalization
Correct.
Of skills. So that's
right.
kind of the next
okay.
place you want to go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you want to add anything, Gordon?
No. Mr. Ruggiero.
Okay.
Well, I'll make a motion to approve the personal wellness course and that the team will decide through the IEP meetings or 504 meetings, the waiver of the graduation requirement.
And we're going to write that in the policy or in the actual course description.
Can you say that one more time? I'm trying to type fast.
Is Gordon?
I think the last line was that the team will decide through a 504 or IEP meeting the waiver for the graduation requirement.
Okay, got it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That motion carries.
Thank you very much.
It's going to be great.
Yep. Thank you.
Excellent.
Okay.
We got to catch on that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, very good. Moving along to the Assistant Superintendent for business report, 5.2.1, Meadowbrook Library beneficiary of $500. Pam, take it away.
Yes, in your packet, you'll see that Meadowbrook is requesting the approval from the school committee for a $500 donation honoring Rebecca Leckberg, who was a 19-year speech and language pathologist and school volunteer here in East Long Meadow. There was a really nice letter written with a donation that says, "This donation is made possible by a group of her Westboro High School friends who, since their 50th class reunion in 2014, have gathered together frequently to eat, laugh, and reminisce under the name of the Ladies Who Lunch. We now have one empty chair at the table, and the surviving members who contributed include Linda Carlson Lightbody, Sheila Brown Healy, Linda Carney Toby, Ann Burroughs Servari, Carol Sackrell, Barbara Bonin Newell, and myself. The woman who wrote the letter was Bonnie Ellis. And they've given a book plate that they're going to put into each of the books. It's really beautiful. It says Meadowbrook School Library. This book is donated in loving memory of Rebecca Becky Leckberg, who passed away in 2016. She was a speech pathologist and school volunteer, a Meadowbrook staff member from 1987 to 2006. By the Westboro High School class of 1964, Ladies Who Lunch, books are friends, come let us read.
Yes, it is.
I remember Mrs. Leckberg. I graduated with her daughter, and so great lady. And I know as a professional, as a speech and language pathologist, certainly an asset to the community. And I know she was missed, and she will be missed by a lot. So
it's a wonderful donation.
Yeah, very nice. So with that, I'll move that we accept the generous donation of $500 honoring Becky Leckberg.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries.
Great, we'll get that deposit.
Thank you. Okay, moving along to item six, old business. 6.1, fundraising policy, second reading.
Okay, in your package, we have the fundraising policy and the fundraiser approval form coming back before you. There were just a few minor changes that we made in the policy. Actually, I think just one change in the first paragraph, and then adding to the bottom of the form, we wanted to make sure that, to the top of the form, that the, in bold there, this form must be approved no later than 1 week in advance of the start of any fundraising policy.
I hate to nitpick.
That's why it comes back.
The fundraising activity, the first, second, third sentence. No fundraising activity may begin without approval from the building principal. I think it should state no fundraising activity within the building.
Okay.
Because obviously we have so many groups. I'll look at the high school, look at the Booster Club, the robotics. They're all outside the building, and we have very little control over that. So this
Robotics we do.
Yeah.
The boosters are different.
Yeah,
the boosters are different. But anything school related, under school control, like robotics, I think is the principal.
It is.
But I do want to say within the building. You know what I'm saying? Because right now this is saying that, that no fundraising activity may begin without approval from the building principal. None.
Well, I mean, we can't, I don't think we have jurisdiction over boosters. So
no, we don't.
Okay,
I think it's I know what you're saying, and I agree with what you're saying and your point, but I think it's implied. We certainly could say it, that, you know, activities related to the building or within the jurisdiction of the principal or something of that nature, I suppose.
I mean, one of the reasons why we took out, I think one of the versions, and this was at the subcommittee level, took out parents, was because they're not really governed by the building principal, although they might be working in coordination with the building principal, such as PTO or that kind of thing.
Well, so then is it all fundraising done by East Long Meadow Public School staff?
We had a lengthy discussion on this.
Is that under, are there things that are also under jurisdiction that don't relate to staff? What do you have?
Do you feel it needs to be repeated? The first sentence in that paragraph says the building principal will approve all fundraising activities in his or her school. You would just like to have
Do we need that sentence then, I guess?
Well, the first sentence, I think, hits it. You're right.
It does hit.
Yeah. I think it's simply saying that, you know, you can't start and then seek permission later.
Okay. Oh, the legal way it is. Okay, fine.
That was the intent.
Okay. I did say I was nitpicking, so good.
No fundraising activity builds up.
Yeah.
Okay, start.
Thank you, Ms. Senior, that's good, I appreciate it.
The other thought I had, and along the lines of our discussion last week was, would it be a good idea to ask for percentage of fundraising monies that actually benefit East Long Meadow Public Schools, meaning...
What's the percentage that we...
If you do a fundraiser for the robotics, 100% of the funds are going to go to the robotics team, right? But if we do the cup stacking thing, what's the percentage we actually get back? Do we get 5% back? Do we get 75% back?
Mm-hmm. One of the forms...
That way...
One of the forms that we looked at had that information, like how much did the fundraiser make and what went back to the school.
Right, but even I would think what, you know, if we sign up for the wrapping paper one, we would know ahead of time,
right,
for every dollar you raise, we'll return, yeah, expect you, right? So if we could track that number, I think that's the one that really gets, mm-hmm, us to where we want,
right,
to be in terms of, let's not waste everybody's money on, you know, things that 80% goes to some private organization and we get 20%,
right?
Right? Maybe there's value to that, but I don't know. But let's track that. And let's ask that question so that people are at least thinking about that when they're doing a fundraising activity, that if they're asking parents to fork over $20, $40, how much of that is actually coming back to the schools?
Would you put a question on the...
I think it goes on the form.
Yeah.
What percentage of the fundraising directly goes directly to East Long Meadow Public Schools?
Well,
what if they're doing, because you're still going to have to fill out this form for like Heart Association, anything like that.
But let's ask the question.
Yeah.
How would we word it so that...
Zero is the answer to that, right?
Okay.
But it's a relevant question.
That's all right. Okay, that's fine.
Because we should know that.
Yeah.
And then even in the end, if we could get an update on how much was actually raised, right? So if we raise $10,000 for the Heart Association, great. It's a great fundraiser, but zero comes back to the town of East Long Meadow. So we now asked all of our parents to raise $10,000, but we get zero of it. You know?
It could almost be a two-part. You could have a percentage that is donated. What percentage of funds raised is donated? And then you have it, is it a community organization or is it back to the East Long Meadow Public Schools?
Right.
So you can see how much is going to community service and how much is going back to the school.
Yeah.
I think some of the response from, we did take a form similar to that to the leadership team.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
They were feeling that advisors might have trouble. Not so much the first question you asked, which is,
right,
you know, if we do Yankee Candles, how much is going to the Yankee Candle Company and what,
right,
percentage is coming back? That one they probably could answer. When you start getting into the jump rope for heart and that kind of thing in terms of tracking how much have they made, how much is going to the...
Well, I don't think how much is the percentage.
No.
So
yeah,
it's
right,
if it's
that
a community
you have
service,
to know.
It'd be 100% of the funds raised are...
Going to the heart.
Right.
Right.
That
right.
initial one had, what do you think you're going to make?
Yeah.
I think we were like,
No. That's not a real,
it doesn't
get you there. I think the percentage gets you there, and then finally what they made. I think it would be
worth,
you know, getting an update, and please, after you've completed your fundraising,
to,
you know,
complete
the form and give us, you know, maybe we put it on there and to say, you know, to be filled out after the fundraising and send us another copy so that just at the end of a year we could see, all right, we've asked from these different avenues, and it says the school on there. Does it say the school?
Name of
it. It's
like
the building, but
the building.
It will have the building principal, right?
Just so we can track, you know, okay, how much is Meadowbrook asking for?
Right.
How much is Mountain View asking for? What percentages are they keeping? How much are they retaining? Which fundraisers are
worthwhile?
Effective?
Right.
Which ones are not worth all the
right.
time and effort we do? You know?
Would the amount finally raised come back in the form of the deposits that are made, though, instead of having them fill out? Isn't there a deposit when they deposit the money?
But if it's the student activities, then that goes right to the town hall, so it doesn't come through my office. So what I'm thinking is that we could, you know, have the principal sign off on it as the initial, and then we don't get it down at central office until after it's ended, and then the accountability, we could add something that then we get that, so that we can then, you know, keep track of that and start to see that. And again, we did talk about the fact that we haven't had a fundraising, you know, policy before. This is something new, and it certainly can be a work in progress. So I don't think it has to be perfect to begin with, but, you know, I think we're moving in the right direction here.
Right, but we at least want to have the information that we're interested in knowing, which is, you know, really what's your worthwhile,
what
how much are we making off
but
these?
But I think we can tweak the policy to your statement, Pam. we can tweak the policy based on what we see for, you know, what we get back in feedback on the data, on the percentage.
Oh, you mean over time?
Over time. You can look at it in another year and see where did it go?
Right.
As, you know, to your point, as a work in progress.
Exactly, so we can revise that.
To make this even more, make it work here.
I was gonna ask.
How many Key Club fundraisers do you have?
That's mostly all we do.
Yeah, so they have to fill this form every single time they have, they do a fundraiser?
Yes, I was thinking about it.
Well, this is what we got into at the leadership team, is that you're, it's making more work for some advisors, and the worry is that are they gonna, not Key Club necessarily, but are some advisors now gonna just not fund this?
Yeah. I mean, could something like the Key Club do a blanket, one for the year?
I think it would be challenging because there's so many specific activities that they raise the money for. And it may change each year.
Like, we're having a fundraiser this week too, for the Ramadana House.
Yeah.
So, like, we do fundraisers all the time.
Now, how often do you find, like, okay, you find out about a fundraiser, how much lead time do you have?
Well, I usually announce a fundraiser at my meetings, like, 2-3 weeks in advance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
How many throughout the year would you say the Key Club is?
Do about one or two a month.
It's a lot.
In some form, yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot.
The form is not that daunting.
No, the form isn't that daunting. We tried to keep it as simple as possible because we did, I mean, one of the forms we looked at was 3 pages. And, you know, we can't have anything that cumbersome. And we tried to dumb it down as much as possible based on the leadership team's recommendations because they're the ones that actually have to deal with it. But I don't have a problem putting something in there about percentage.
I think this is good because the principal should know what the Key Club is doing. Does the principal know?
Hey, of course.
How would she find out? How would she know?
Well, she usually just knows what we do because it's the Key Club. This everything we do is fundraising, so.
It's just a basic, it's a premise.
Alerting her what.
Yeah, Ms. Reed's the teacher advisor, so she's.
Oh, okay.
This kind of formalizes the process.
Right.
It's a, like you said, it's a one page.
It could be the responsibility of the new president to do this.
There you go.
Well, I was going to say, you can have, all right, some of the students fill it out.
Yeah, it doesn't have to necessarily be the advisor. Yeah,
and then it just goes to the approval, of the principal.
Well, maybe back to Ms. Assistant Superintendent of the Business point, maybe we just try it out, see how it goes, and.
But do we want to add anything about percentage?
Do you want to revise the form?
Do you want to revise the form?
Revise and bring it back again.
Yeah.
I mean, we can table this until the next meeting and revise the form and bring it back again.
Yeah.
If that's the way. Is everybody good with the policy itself?
Yes.
Yes.
So then we're only working on the form?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
How's that sound?
Sounds good.
Good.
All right, so we don't even need a motion to do anything with this. We'll bring it back in our next meeting with a revised form. You've got the notes, Pam?
Yep.
Between the two of you.
Yep.
We'll figure it all out. Yep. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, moving along to 6.2, the draft of the statement of interest for the high school.
Okay, in your packets you have the most recent draft of our statement of interest for East Long Meadow High School. It's approximately 36 pages.
Yep.
And we've revised it, obviously, every year. This year we've looked at, specifically with Mrs. Mayhew's help, a couple of the high schools that were brought into the program in this past fiscal year. And we think actually our statement of interest comparatively does quite well against those two that we used, that we know were invited into the process.
Well, I'll compliment you, Mr. Smith. This is very impressive. I read this. It was, how many years have we done this now? It's the fourth?
It's the fourth year.
Fourth year. Well, I know we have to remain persistent if we want to get into high school, but very impressive, Mr. Smith.
Ms. Mayhew came up with some good, she did a little research and found some interesting.
She had some good terms.
Yeah.
Well, I do have to give the little shout out to Teresa Ravosa, too, who's in our audience tonight.
Yeah.
She's a parent in town who has concerns about the high school. And she's also, you know, read some of the past statement of interests also, so we tried to go back and reflect some of that same language in the other schools. But what we did notice is one of the schools has, like, overcrowding to a point where they were busting out of their building out of it. So, but we do have it in some of our classrooms in terms of we really tried to emphasize the classrooms are below standard.
Right.
Undersized.
In size.
Right.
From what's recommended for the MSBA. really just talking about the impact that the school has on the students in their daily learning, whether it's the heating and cooling, the technology piece. We made sure to talk a little bit more about.
To go over the safety of the labs.
Well, mm-hmm. I did actually mention.
You talked about the overcrowding of the labs.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Therefore, it's not preparing them for true lab experience as they go on to college.
Right.
I just had that overwhelming fear that electrical piece going out and they can't find it for 2 weeks. We have to shut the high school down.
Yeah.
I had that overwhelming fear. It's a nightmare.
Well, the roof is what scares me. Well. When it rains, more buckets going out. And I do have to say, it's like when you do drive up to the school, it looks nice on the outside.
Yes.
We have to say a lot for our staff and the janitors, and our DPW does a great job of maintaining what they can, but it is just getting to a point where the maintaining is just becoming too tough, too expensive.
Let's hope this is the year.
Well, right. I mean,
I hope so.
Page 6, has the district had any recent teacher layoffs or reductions? Is it advantageous to answer yes or no? What would you think?
I think it shows that we're, budgets have been fiscally conservative, and, 2014-2015
recent is
year.
A relative term now that we're on year four.
Right.
So I wouldn't have a problem saying no either if that's advantageous to us.
I don't know if it...
Well, the one above us says yes. The one above us says yes when we reduced it 3 years ago.
That's what I'm saying.
Right.
Right. So what's relative?
But
it's
better to say no because it's not is that recent anymore. I mean, it is. Or,
yeah, this wasn't so effective, wasn't it?
Yeah, right. But
impacting the high school from the standpoint it was a custodian that was lost here.
Yeah.
But is that what they're looking for? MSBA, do they look favorable on a town that has had recent cuts, or do they look favorable on a town that funds education and doesn't have recent
cuts?
Well,
they want to see a commitment to education. Yeah, they want
to see,
right.
To say,
but so to that point, recent is, that could go either way. 2014-15 is, it's relative, it is.
Yeah.
So we could say no and still be not, we'd be telling the truth still. I'm just saying, what's more advantageous?
Yeah.
And then to that point, if we leave it as yes, then should the next page, the top of page 7, should we talk about, especially, it says consequences of the teacher reductions. I mean, should we talk about it? But that's not at the high school, I guess. Is that why? So you have,
well, they do ask you about your most recent budget approval process, including a description.
After that, though.
And
after
so,
that.
Right.
But I'm saying if we answer yes to the question about layoffs.
It changes everything. Right.
So, Mr. Smith, I'm wondering if... because those two questions, it says yes, and then it asks the number of teachers.
Mm-hmm.
The next question says staff. I'm wondering if the four that you talk about in the narrative part for that, the first question that's answered yes,
mm-hmm.
is actually, has the district had any recent staff layoffs, that should say yes, and then include those
The custodian and the other, other than the teacher. Yeah, we could split that up.
Why is that question in there twice?
One's teacher and one's staff.
Industry, yeah.
Although if you look at the description, they don't necessarily, they talk about guidance, administrative.
Yeah. Guidance, maintenance. And,
mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. So we could split that up.
So move the
three down.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it might pull up the custodian piece a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I just wanted to say I was looking at the two SOIs for Sharon and Worcester, and they both say no to those questions.
Right.
Just a comment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I mean, we don't know what their situation
is. Which is the point you're trying to make.
I mean, is that we're not going to have the money? Like, people aren't going to vote for a new school?
Well, we haven't had reductions in the last 2 years. Yeah.
Right.
Is that recent?
So it really isn't, right.
Is that recent?
So what?
Yeah. Well, again,
so you can take it out.
Yeah. If they said 5 years, that's one thing, but recent is another.
Right.
Right, year to year.
Yeah.
I think I'd leave it the way it is.
I think I'd take it out. About that.
Well, I don't know how much of an impact it's going to have.
I don't know either. I mean, are we being nitpicky? I don't know.
Yeah.
Probably. I'm just saying,
You should probably define recent.
What you could do is you could say that the custodian at the high school is still being the largest building.
Maybe like last budget.
You could argue it that way.
Yeah,
or you can, as you said, maybe it's not recent enough anymore.
Right. Especially if it's
it could still be noted there.
Yeah.
Well, or we could say, you know, these were in 1415. However, since then, the town has fully acknowledged the needs of the district, and we haven't had layoffs.
I mean, if you in a different scenario, if you say your building is overcrowded and you've had recent layoffs, well, that they go hand in hand, okay? Whereas this isn't. I don't know if this is going to impact anything.
You're probably right. Probably doesn't impact anything.
I just
it's an elementary school teacher. It's all.
That's not going to impact.
That's not going to impact the high school. Really, so we're looking at a custodian.
But I'm wondering if the crux of their question is getting at, does the town
support
fund and support, better word, support education.
Yeah. You know.
Well, I mean, you're also getting at it through the NEAC process, because we're on warning for community resources. See what I'm saying? So we're saying, and not even us, the NEAC, if you read that report, is saying that the town is not putting the money to the resources of the school in terms of renovations and technology and so forth.
Right.
It's addressed in a different way.
Right, but that's a different...
It's a different narrative.
That's capital versus staffing.
Yeah. True. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good point.
I don't know. I think maybe I'm just reading into it too much.
No, you wonder if they're thinking.
Well, I do have to separate it out either way.
Yeah.
Put the.
So.
When you make a motion,
if you can give me guidance on whether you want
to
separate
the other thing
it out
to that,
or just
separate it. I think in terms of what it is, mm-hmm. I think we'd be better to have it gone. Because that gets at the crux of maintaining the building. Mm-hmm. We can say we maintain our building, but if we're cutting custodial staff, then
makes
are we?
It more challenging.
Yeah. I think we yank it. Because it's not recent, it's 3 years now.
Right. Again, it speaks to the relativity of
which reason. It says that too, so and they're smart enough to say, well, that was 3 years ago, but is it easier to say no and me and then they move on?
I was looking to see if there's some sort of a definition.
There's no.
No,
but
there
isn't. Going back
happened
and comparing
only a
our
short
statement.
While ago.
That, I don't know if they do or not.
Do they compare statement of interest each year? That,
but it's
oh,
fine,
like, it's
because
long
we're
now,
not recent
it's,
anymore.
It's, no. Right, that's what I'm saying.
It's not recent anymore, yeah.
It's not like we added it back
I
in.
I know that it helps us to have it in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess it's the end in the end, right?
So then the answer would be no and no.
Right.
That saves a lot of work, too.
But that's already done.
That's easier, right?
It's already done.
But with the overcrowding, how, like, we put no on that, should we say yes and give specifics? Like, yes, like, you know, there are some, you even look at our culinary arts.
Yeah,
is that overcrowded?
I give specifics in terms of
the AP Calc class, like, there were too many people in the class. That some person had to have like a mini desk next to my teacher's desk.
You're right. Yes.
Yeah. So I do give specifics around specific classes.
Okay.
But to claim overcrowding as a school,
they mean overall.
They mean overall.
They
mean overall as a building.
The school was built for over 1,000 students,
right.
And we have 860. So you
and they
can't
know that.
Claim
they know that data.
Well, they know that, but you know there weren't.
That's
I mean, let's just use this new health policy. I mean, since the school was built for 1,000 students, mm-hmm. we've had all kinds of changes to the curriculum and how many classes, the number of classes offered back in 1960 is nowhere near what they offer today.
Yeah,
true.
You know, so I'm just pulling straws.
Well, no, he does put a lot of, you know, this isn't conducive to 21st century learning.
Okay.
We're missing
well,
out.
Right. Well,
and there is an opportunity where I think it does say, are there any classes that you can't offer? And I know we've had things like the CAD is one, the technology,
CAD, the
so maybe we can add something for our social and emotional students that we're looking to add something, but we're having a difficult time finding an actual classroom mm-hmm. place.
To Beth's point, I think the NEASC warnings speak to a lot of what you're talking about as far as what they see as far as the academics, what they're looking for, and the fact that the building is not up to 21st century standards. That was
spoken. But the NEASC, I think we had a warning only under one area.
Community resources.
Yeah. But that speaks to, you know, it speaks to the whole picture, I think. It's
well,
so complex. The statement
that,
of interest.
I know but when you look at other statement of interest, they have warnings on the actual, like, building.
Their whole status of accreditation.
So that's the problem, is their accreditation is even on the line. Where ours isn't. We passed.
Yeah.
The accreditation, so
with the exception of that one standard.
Well,
So, I don't want to get too nitpicky on a lot of the stuff, but if we go back to 2013 on the facility study, so I'm on page 7 now, the next page,
mm-hmm.
and we talk about the $24 million in capital projects And then we say those projects are estimated to go up 4% every year, which without even compounding, that's 20% over 5 years. That doesn't compound, that's probably more like 23, 24. Well, then that 24 million is now, you know, 28 and change.
Right.
Well, we want to make that the number, you know, or say that, you know, in the 4% increase.
The specific projects actually are, we've done the 4% increase by project on our capital plan.
Okay.
Yeah, so the 24 million is what they originally identified as a number of urgent projects in the facility study.
Okay.
And then
the 11.
The 11 are the ones we say this year, if you look at our spreadsheets, are the most urgent. So that's the roof, that's the electrical.
Okay.
I think the parking lot's in there. Mm-hmm. And those numbers each year, as I call Sims, Maney, and McKee, they give me what projects, what they're seeing in the industry. So it's been 3, 3, 4 over the last 3 years.
Okay. Can we say in this year's capital request?
Yep.
Again, it gets away from that foggy recent number. because that right there is a big part of our argument, mm-hmm. are those few sentences. We have $24 million that were established 5 years ago, so now you're looking at $28 to $30 million on just maintaining what we have.
Right.
With 11 and change are urgent, and in all likeliness will never be funded without a major comprehensive renovation with some assistance from MSBA.
Right.
I mean,
right. That's,
we funded $1 million the last townwide.
We're 2 years from our accreditation already, right? It takes a process now to just get them to approve the school. We could be sitting in the school still the next time the accreditation, even if the new one's being built, mm-hmm. at that point. It's not going to fare well.
Did you say somewhere in here about the town's capital investments over the last couple of years?
We say not in terms of the rest of the town, just the high school.
Just in terms of high school projects that we've done?
Projects
we've
done.
It asks how it's all budgeted.
You do talk about only have $1 million for each year and how it doesn't satisfy.
I do say that.
Yeah. Okay, that's what I'm getting at.
It says later on. I think it's in the beginning somewhere.
It is.
Well, when is this due?
I have to have it in the mail a week from Wednesday.
I could overnight it
on Thursday.
Yeah.
It has to be there Friday.
I think he knows what we're
doing. Yeah, I think it's a solid thought.
I mean,
I've taken notes and I'm open to further revisions.
Yeah, so anybody that's got anything else?
It's a group right.
Yeah. Oh, I had mentioned something about like student safety, like certain areas can't be locked down or in the evening we can't close halls. I think you would get into some
fire situations with that, fire code situations, because buildings in the 90s used to chain doors and mm-hmm. lock wings down,
right?
And they no longer do that because of fire codes.
Okay.
I used to remember doing that.
I was saying buildings in general, I wasn't really bringing it to East.
Yeah.
But Mr. Fichero just outed.
Yeah.
Outed the high school.
Yeah. All right. I guess that if anybody's got any other ideas.
Good job.
Yeah.
No,
but
it's
a lot of work.
It's a lot of work, and it's a good statement, so. Just see what happens.
And who knows if our fourth time around.
I'm feeling lucky.
I'm feeling
lucky.
Yeah,
you know,
you've
got lucky.
Yeah. All right.
I got to make the motion. That's how lucky I feel.
Okay. Go ahead.
I say
that we approve the SOI for the East Long Meadow High School for the upcoming year.
With the recommended
amendments.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries.
Okay, now, as part of those recommended changes, we're saying pull the recent layoffs and just go no.
Say no.
Okay.
Correct.
Thank you.
Okay, moving along to item 7, new business. 7.1, school choice 2017-2018 school year discussion.
So, by law, each year, school committee needs to discuss and vote to either participate in the state school choice program or not to participate in the school choice program. Historically, for probably the last 15 years, if not more, East Long Meadow School Committee has voted to not participate in the school choice program. I gave you some recent enrollment statistics just to give you an idea of where class sizes in terms of overall students per grade level. And we did a, similar to last year, we did it in a leadership team meeting. This year, I did it more as a survey. Although not a consensus, you do have the majority of the leadership team recommending looking at school choice at specific grade levels. For example, right now you have kindergarten at about 171, so you probably could invite a certain number of slots into kindergarten. You could also invite a certain number of slots into first grade. As you look, your highest classes, grade 9 currently has 224 students, and grade 7 has 224 students. But then you have grades such as grade 5 with 195, grade 8 with 189.
See, that's the place to go. You have grade 8 coming in to the freshman year, 189,
right.
And
right.
Grade 12, 217 leaving,
right.
Gaining 28 slots there,
right.
If we were to do it.
If you were to do it.
Right.
And you're going to get more applications at the transition grades. You know, you'll see more people looking for school choice or calling about school choice as students get ready to go to middle school.
Mm-hmm.
So for the
right.
sixth grade,
yeah,
or for ninth grade. At the elementary, I don't know the statistics on that, but I'm assuming that you know, people might be interested in coming into a school at either at the kindergarten or first grade level.
We don't, and it's a rhetorical mainly because I don't have it, but we don't know how many students were in the now grade 12 class in kindergarten or first grade, do we? In terms of a trend and how many we added between in the last 12 years?
No. Yeah, it's a good question. I don't have that.
Well, I think the current sixth grade had 185 in my head.
when they started?
They were kindergartners. And they're 214 now.
So they're plus 30 almost?
I think that's pretty typical. So I'm looking at third grade at 199.
Yeah.
I think when my youngest was in kindergarten, I think we were like at 150 or 160.
Yeah, kindergarten has stayed somewhere in the 160s or low 170s.
I think the current fifth grade was low. It had gone down 20 less kids than the current sixth grade.
Yeah. I remember seeing something like that.
Yeah. But they've already transitioned into the next level school,
correct.
The fifth into the sixth. And you could see where it jumps. The eighth is higher than the ninth.
Yeah.
You know, so I wonder if it just happens by people who move in to town anyways with children at certain ages when they get to junior high, or you know, middle school when they get to the high school.
Right.
You know. Yeah, because that fifth grade is where we lost a few teachers because there were so few coming in. I think that's when we lost, like, you know, the
third. Well, we have to move them.
Yeah.
Yeah. To balance for Title I. So the leadership team is recommending that we...
It's not a consensus.
Not a consensus.
But it's
the
majority.
Building principles that we would recommend additions to recommending?
Yes.
Like they're not saying, yeah, go ahead and put them in another, okay.
Which
ones specifically, which grade levels are specifically...
They didn't get into grade levels, but generally the consensus, if I go to last year's, discussion is if you're going to do it, try to do it in the earlier grade level so someone's growing up in the East Long Meadow Public Schools.
And we can do that. We can be specific and say we're just going to open up three slots in this grade level.
And remember, with school choice, you're not getting the per pupil expenditure. You're simply getting $5,000.
And we have to consider that.
So your per pupil expenditure right now for East Long Meadow is just over $14,000.
You know, all you need
is
one challenging student for a step
and that's the other problem.
Right, but this is where I'm coming from now, and I know I may be told off because I don't know how anyone feels about it, but I also feel as a committee we voted against the state expanding any charter school back in the fall, and I just feel it just is the right thing to maybe open it up, and if we have some people on the leadership team that are willing to open up some slots, you know, I'd be willing to entertain some school choice students, but obviously it has to be a majority vote.
I'll throw it out there. I'm concerned about the budgetary constraints when things are going to get tight. It's not going to get, you know, it's not. I don't think it's going to get any better.
Right. But also, when you have students coming in at school choice, these are students who want to be here. The parents have to be engaged. They have to drive their students to the school.
Oh, I know.
You know, they're going to be, these parents who are seeking this out, knowing that you know, you're going to get a family that's involved and has a child that wants to be here.
Do I have to provide busing?
No, they don't have busing. The parent is responsible for the child.
It's their responsibility.
When we last did this, this was a long time ago. I would say that...
And I'm okay if I'm in the minority here. It's okay.
That was not the case.
That was not the case.
Not the case.
Okay. Because other people that I've spoken to, and, you know, they've been, you know, they benefited from school choice.
Yes.
Right.
I guess, I'm going back, I think it's at least when it first started, the faculty, with me being a facility, had a big discussion on this. And what they overwhelmingly voted was that we're not going to become one of those schools that's going to take advantage of a school system next door that's challenging right now and take their money, because what happens is that money comes off of their budget.
Right.
So if we take 10 kids for the ninth grade, that's $50,000 out of, say, X town's budget.
Mm-hmm.
And philosophically, we felt that we don't need to do that to support our school system, to rob from the poor, or whatever you want to put it, and get to the rich.
I guess I have a question. If they only give us a hot $5,000, okay, because to me that's just like, it's not even worth a headache. But it's costing that school system, their per pupil cost, say, is $13,000 or $14,000. They're losing, what's that town losing? Just $5,000?
Yes,
they lose five.
Yeah, but the costs don't change, so our per pupil costs aren't going to change.
No, I mean, it's not going to be that much. But you could, it's the luck of the draw, and you could end up with a student that has significant needs. I mean, somebody could move in with significant needs.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
it's also, and you could find, you know, for your $5,000, you could have a student that's going to have significant needs, and we're going to have to take care of those needs.
Does that fall on the receiving district's budget?
Yes.
You can apply for some relief. I don't know the avenues for school choice. Obviously, the avenues for students who are already here, that's through the circuit breaker. So
right.
once you spend over $40,000, you can then apply for some relief,
right.
and then they will possibly, if it meets their criteria, give you right now, I think it's 70%, 73% of what you spend
over 40,000.
Over 40,000.
But then again, we don't know what the number is going to be for next year.
Right. Now, I don't know whether with a school choice situation, if you apply through Circuit Breaker, or whether they ask you to apply through some other means.
Well, I would imagine Circuit Breaker if it's our cost anyway. It's just like any other
friend,
right?
Which then means that you may not get, you know, it may not meet the criteria, which I think is what you're alluding to.
Right.
Yeah.
Do we know how many Long Meadow still participates in school?
Yeah, they do.
Wilbraham.
Hamden Wilbraham does
quite a few.
Long Meadow is very specific to,
very small, very specific.
Just a few grade levels, and they'll do exactly as I was saying, where they'll say, okay, we have two slots in grade one,
right.
we have one slot in grade three, and we have a slot in grade seven.
And they're very
it's that small
yeah.
numbers that they
yeah.
actually
yeah.
do.
Mm-hmm.
So, do we know why they do it?
No.
What their logic is?
It could be just based on where their enrollments
just
look.
Their enrollment.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because then you could really, I mean, if you only have 10 students and you have, like you said, a heavy hitter that's 40,000 in, I mean,
mm-hmm.
it's all for naught.
Right.
I mean, it's
right.
not, it's for, you know.
Right.
But if you're only looking at the dollars and cents.
All right, whatever motion needs to be made in the positive.
Right.
I move that we accept school choice at the trip. How many
participate?
The motion. Participate.
I
move that we participate in the school choice program for the upcoming school year.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
I don't know. I mean, how strongly is the recommendation of the leadership team? They really want to do it. They're willing to do it.
I think in some cases it's hard actually through a survey to get that. But last year there were some that were more passionate than others. Mm-hmm. This year the survey, the reason we had to do a survey is we didn't have a leadership team meeting last week. It was originally on the agenda, and then I had to cancel the meeting due to some other meetings that had to take priority. Based on last year's, you have people that are willing to get involved and certainly open up certain grade levels. I think some are more passionate than others, but it's not a consensus. you do have some on the leadership team who, at least responded in the survey, no, they do not participate.
Would one of those, you said the lower levels are more...
The discussion last year was saying that if we are going to get involved in school choice, the recommendation would be try to do it at the younger levels,
okay,
wherever possible. So that you have a student growing up in the East Long Meadow Public Schools instead of coming in, say, in the
kind of similar to our Medco program, I guess.
Right.
Yeah.
Except Medco provides transportation.
Can we increase that?
You can.
Because
And we are looking to do that because we're actually under-enrolled.
Right.
Originally,
yeah,
we were... so we have met this year with Susan Jackson and the principals to look at grade levels where, for whatever reason, students have withdrawn, mm-hmm, and so now we're not, the MECO program is not represented at those grade levels we're looking to reestablish.
I mean, that I think is more worthy,
mm-hmm,
somehow.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Then it's not, I don't know.
Well, it's an established program.
It is.
The
well, I guess
right,
it's, yeah,
the support for the students.
It's
busing for the students. It's, yeah,
yeah,
it makes more sense than just throwing 10 kids,
yeah,
into the ninth grade and saying go, you know?
Right, right.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say nay.
Nay.
Nay. Nay. Motion fails. We will not participate.
But can we look into the MECO?
Yeah,
we are.
We are.
Yeah.
I know, usually you're the one that's always fun.
All right. Moving along to 7.2.
Communication
strategy on the statement of interest for the high school. And this was a request that was brought to me by Deidre.
Now I'm causing problems tonight.
No, I mean, we had a lengthy discussion.
What you're here for.
Yeah, we had a lengthy discussion on this, and she's got some very good ideas, and, you know, you can start leading the discussion.
Sure. So something that has been brought to my attention just through parents when I'm out and about town is everyone's always like, what's going on with the high school? And I know we try to get information out there.
Mm-hmm.
The internet, or maybe you've made the phone call on the Connect Ed, and we're just trying to come up with different ways or strategies that we can utilize to really get the word out about giving updates, getting information out there to our parents. And this may expand to just a larger, you know, type of communication across the district, because you go on the website, it's really not as user-friendly as I've seen other school websites,
mm-hmm,
or district websites. When Greg and I did our tours of the different schools, I asked the building principals about their websites too, and it seems like none of them are connected. It would really be great to see some consistency,
mm-hmm,
through those websites. So I know it started out with just talking about communication strategy on statement of interest for the high school, but I think it also can be expanded to a greater net of also the district. But going back to the high school, this is...
Yeah, well, I think the discussion probably starts and centers around the high school, because we are actively still pursuing
right,
a comprehensive project, and are about to submit another SOI. So, you know, I agree with you. Yeah, we've got to blow this thing up at some point, but I think this is where we start.
Right.
Now, you can, on the website, which has received a facelift,
right,
you can do two things. One, you have the news section, which seems to be now getting more people looking at it. So we had something in there on the MSBA process. I think it's got like 169-170 views.
Mm-hmm.
There's a section on the bottom. So that's, no matter how you add to the news section, if you click view all, you'll see all of them, and whatever your last one added is the one that actually is there when you go to the website. So right now it's advertising Dr. Potee's, the presentation with the Youth Safety Committee.
Mm-hmm.
So they would have to click view all. If you go to the bottom, I think there are four panels.
Mm-hmm.
There's one that I think right now says either school department or Mountain View all the way to the right.
School department, and then it shows Mountain View schools.
Okay, so that one we could, if you are dedicating something just to the statement of interest or updates on the MSBA, you could have that be a new link and call it whatever we want, and then you link to a page where you just keep updating information on this.
Yeah, I think the key to that is to push out, though. I think we need to to tweet and other forms of social media, because we need to make people aware or send them links to go to there.
Yeah, that it's there.
Because I'm on the school committee and I haven't seen a lot of this stuff. So I can only imagine that people aren't necessarily visiting often. Right. So I think important things like that, people get the notification and then link into it.
Sure.
I think it'd be helpful.
I think it's kind of a comprehensive approach. I mean, all the five buildings have newsletters they put out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that we should start getting something, and then it was just a paragraph with these newsletters.
And the newsletters.
The newsletters. It's got to be user-friendly on that. I mean, when you just describe, well, you got to go down, it's in the back.
The website is not user-friendly.
Well, but I think I really think we got to get to the point that we're sending links to people. Even the student newsletter, if I'm lucky and I hit it right, I'll see it, but I don't see it all the time just because of the amount of stuff.
You can probably do that through Blackboard Connect.
Okay.
If everybody has their emails, you can send, hey, there's a new recent update, and you can send them the link. I can send them the link to the webpage, or possibly I'll have to research whether I can send them the link to that exact part of the webpage that we were talking about.
Can we think about in the restaffing of central office and as we go forward, making more of a social media presence part of a job description somewhere? Because I think it is important to get information out to people. And the way it is the way it is. You need to push it out to people because they're not going to just come get it necessarily.
You have to hit every form of media.
Right.
You know, we have LCAT. We can, you know, we have our meetings on there. You have Reminder. That's always going to be an important one because you're going to hit some people there. And then we've got to get on to any of the social media, whether it's going to be Twitter, Facebook.
Or both.
I know, but and the only issue I have with Facebook is that they always change their algorithms, that you're not always going to see everything show up in your news feeds. Mm-hmm. And again, there are times I'll be like, oh, look, school committee agenda posted on my Facebook feed. I'm like, oh, great. And then I don't see it for months.
Yeah,
I don't see another one for months. And I'm like, what just happened? It was so nice getting it on there.
Yeah,
right. Especially the other town. You got a meeting you're supposed to be in, you forgot about.
Yeah, well, two years ago at the MASS conference, there were several sessions on social media and the use and the advantages of it. And one of the things that, you know, Gordon and I were both there, Beth, you were there with us, and one of the things they said is you need a dedicated person to be managing this, to your point of, you know, and to everybody's point about, you know, we're going to be undergoing some changes in central office, is there a way to craft something? And this might be the time to do it.
And I mean, we got to think about like our policy with it too, because if we have a Facebook presence, do we want people to be able to comment on it or not? If we've got a Twitter feed, you know, so there's all those little tiny things that we've got to learn more about, because I think it should be basic information. And information only, not
comments.
Anybody's thoughts on anything, you know, but that these are so that.
You're going to get things though when you put it out there. It's going to happen.
I mean,
it's going to happen.
You are, but I'm talking about the person who posts.
So our audience, I think, is us.
Our audience.
Right. Parents, right?
Right.
Because we're in the school, so we want to get the parents. The way I get news now is through Twitter and Western Mass News whatever else I'm following.
So it might actually be...
And I'm reading through the feed, and I see what I like, and I click on it, right?
Yeah.
And then I go, it takes me right to where
Twitter
feed. Yeah. And that's how I get it. Otherwise, I'm not going to esalmeadowgov.ma.
For the Key Club, like I made a Key Club Twitter and I run it and I make news tweets all the time. So it's helpful.
You're hired.
Yeah. I do. And I think each of the classes probably have their own Twitter or Facebook or
The high school has
one.
But that's not used often, which is fine. I'm just saying, if you want to get things out.
They
do a lot of sports update and shout outs or when school's canceled.
If school's canceled, it gets out there on Twitter.
So I had dabbled with
and when it's
Twitter
not canceled, it's
pulled back. But I was at a conference last week and listened to one of the keynote speakers, who is a principal in another state, and a large portion of his presentation was around how to reach your community.
Mm-hmm.
And he is on Twitter so much that he was recognized by the White House, asked to come in and do something with his classroom virtually, just because they found him on Twitter. And so I think that it made me rethink, because I dabbled with it and then got rid of it.
Right.
It made me rethink that we really could have a good presence. It's just we have to
probably come together and have some thinking around it.
Right.
But I mean, and have someone dedicated is great, but we could probably start, you know, slower.
Well, yeah.
With people now, like I mean.
Yeah, you just want a woman who has the ability to tweet as he's on a public school.
We would have to have a consensus on what was going out.
Correct.
And then we could take either turns, or I would have no problem. Because it, you know, it really made me change my thinking on it, because I had individually done it and was like, this isn't really meeting my needs, but I changed my mind after seeing what this particular professional.
It's the way to go.
We have a volunteer.
It's the way.
I would absolutely take that.
Like I said, you still have to utilize every other outlet.
Well, this is in addition, yes, yes. But
you want to direct them back to where the more information is.
Correct.
Exactly.
And you could, like you said, links everything.
That's
right there.
Because my concern is, let's say the statement of interest goes through, now we've got to rally up our, you know, our people.
Yeah.
And we have to keep them up to date.
We're going to need focus groups.
Right.
Separate from us.
Right.
To rally the people, but.
So we just need to know what the message is. It doesn't
correct.
Come to get about once we know
I think that kind of going back 4 years, we haven't had a hearing on the high school in 4 years, because we did it at the
correct.
Beginning.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's time to do another hearing right now, update people that's been 4 years, have copies of this available for the public, mm-hmm. because we're brainstorming here. I'm sure there's a lot of people in that audience that will be able to say, hey, here's another idea that you can do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think maybe it's, I don't know, what, maybe May at some
right.
point.
Right, yeah, we talk about the process again.
Yeah.
To Twitter, all
yeah.
that, just.
Well, we can have, you know, some sort of like a town hall
right.
type thing.
Yeah.
Because realize, you know, we may have our school people who are, yes, all for the high
right.
school, but now we still have to convince the greater community.
Well, yeah, there's a
also
great, yeah.
that has no children in the school who.
Right. Well, those are the ones we got to educate.
But it's still a matter of.
Sorry, but they're
educating.
My age bracket. I
yes. So that's why we have to not use Twitter all the time.
Yeah. But I mean, again, you're directing
it. More than right. have it than you know.
But
you
you're directing it. You're directing them back
to
the source.
Multifaceted.
Yeah.
It has
right.
to be multifaceted.
Yeah.
People get their information from so many different sources now, other than. You know, just the website.
The reminder or the
website. 99.9% of them are checking something on their phone,
right? Right.
Like you said, the notification comes
that's
up.
Where you get it.
But
that's where
the link,
I get news.
If the link
see what I read and I read
in,
it.
In the tweet brings you back to something
correct.
On the webpage,
right.
then
yep.
they're going to get more information
yep.
from
yep.
Yeah.
And they might click on other things while they're there.
Yeah. characters isn't going to do it.
No, it's not.
Why don't you keep this as a recurrent agenda item? Just like
sure.
we're going to be out the next couple of weeks.
Right.
And I had a discussion with someone I was weightlifting with last time. So, I mean, you know, the whole discussion.
Yeah.
It just came up spontaneously.
The,
so people
other,
said
we should have weightlifting groups. And
the other thing I wanted
to
mention
you.
Was...
Rich's focus groups. Huh?
Yeah.
Oh,
I know that...
You could start a blog.
I know.
A blog, yeah.
A blog.
I like the Twitter idea.
It's quick, right? You only
yeah,
have to
I
don't know, can you condense it to 140 characters or less?
Well, that'd be a challenge.
Oh.
That's why I kind of like
He'll
I like
say
Twitter.
What he wants to say.
Force me.
But
he said it was good.
But I do think we should have a hearing at some point.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah,
right.
I think
well,
we
you
have
know
to reach out.
I think, you know, let's get on the other side of the budget. We're going to have a budget hearing at some point in April.
In May. Look at it in May.
And we'll look at it in May.
Okay.
The other thing that my thing is when you look at, I know that Birchland and the high school have their own websites, and they're all kind of based on.
It's linked through.
Blackboard Connect.
Right? Well, no, it's actually, it's now linked through, it used to be linked.
Oh, not Rediker?
Trying to think. It is linked through Rediker now.
Okay.
And so it basically was set up so we could connect and launch the student portals, student and parent portals. And so I think, and it actually to your point, Mr. Thompson, the portals have become so much more successful that it almost has made the website obsolete. However, we needed the website in order to launch the portals.
Right.
All right. But I feel that when I look at Meadowbrook, Mapleshade, and Mountain View, there's no consistency between what they use. And I think it's important as we move on to make sure that they look the same, they feel the same, they have links to one another, and that they're updated.
Those are out of building-based budgets, aren't they?
They are.
The
challenge. Well, the challenge there is this. Before we had gone to Civic Plus, which runs the town website, mm-hmm. it's the town vendor. They all had different websites.
Right.
And now they all have different websites, with the exception of Mountain View. They are linked to the town website, so it does look like ours.
It does.
Okay. It does.
All right.
And you could do that. I don't know that.
I just feel,
say,
because
Mr. Fredette and Mrs. Dakin want to go.
I don't know if the information is going to be.
I'm pretty sure Mr. Fredette does not. Because he's worked hard to get his website.
Great. It's not a great site.
I don't see the actual individuals.
But I'm just saying, you know, I don't know why we can't.
Do you have to go to Living In and go to find schools and that?
Well, no, there's something, there should be something on the list that says schools.
Same provider.
Well, I know that.
On the left.
Because we won.
Well, that's what I'm saying, is do you force them into it?
You don't have to.
He's worked.
And he has a lot on his.
I know.
You see it.
Yeah.
But it's paid.
Right.
But.
Okay. All right.
Okay, let's close it up here.
Well, maybe use his.
Okay.
Yeah, it's,
well, it's, yeah.
They're all, I mean, it's all basically, all right, to use a restaurant term, a la carte. So it will be
yeah,
they're all become different cost centers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll bring this back.
Great. Yeah. Thank
you. On our next agenda, yeah, to continue to update everything.
Perfect.
And we'll figure it out. Okay, is there anything else to come before the committee this evening? All right. LCAT recognition, Mr. Mackey, thank you. Emmy, thank you for your contributions tonight. And if there's nothing else, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Good night.